Nostalgia is a powerful thing, but can it be so powerful that it affects our decision making? Think about the Fresh Prince theme song. That should fill you with glee, or likely you're dead inside. That feeling is nostalgia, and while it feels good, it doesn't always lead to making good decisions. So, how does nostalgia permeate the brain, and what exactly does it do to our decision making? Hit me with that theme song, man. I knew you were gonna say that, so I got one. Science. If you know me, you know I love the 90s, especially all the jams. Michael Jackson's Jam, Def Jam, NBA Jam, Jock Jam, Space Jam. Wow, we had a lot of jams back then. And me loving the 90s makes me see the world differently than someone who, say, loves the 1950s. Nostalgia makes you look at the world through rose-colored glasses, and we have an emotional connection to memories, like when we hear No Scrubs in the Club, or when someone else hears Bruce Springsteen on the AM radio. These emotions come from the brain, and you know how this goes. Now I'm gonna do some science, you'll ingest it, we'll have fun. One study out of Japan defined nostalgia as experiencing predominantly positive emotions when remembering autobiographical events. Autobiographies are stories about us, our first date with Tevin Campbell, or when I realized that having fun isn't hard when you have a library card. Nostalgia is our individual memories of what happened within those autobiographies and are affected by the positive emotions we associate with them, the rose-tinted history goggles. Exposure to conditions inspiring nostalgic feelings activate part of the brain associated with three things: memory, emotion, and reward. The amygdala, known to modulate emotional responses, works in tandem with the hippocampus, responsible for memory, to activate parts of the brain linked to reward like the ventral striatum and the substantia nigra, among other regions. So, amygdala and hippocampus, who's the boss? It's Judith Light. Look it up, that's a reference. The amygdala and the hippocampus interact with each other to encode our memories, and research suggests that they may actually govern two different memory encoding mechanisms, but they interact when emotion is involved. Think about a memory that brings you joy. You're getting that warm, positive feeling all over, right? That's dopamine. Positive emotions have been linked to stronger, detail-oriented memories, but research also suggests that memories deteriorate over time, and both positive and negative emotions can have an effect on how we remember incidents, which is part of why eyewitness testimony can be faulty in the courtroom, so hold on to those good times, but they may not be 100% reliable in a court of law. A 2015 study cited the positive effects of nostalgia as a stabilizing force, allowing us to push forward with a sense of personal continuity, a wonderful way to track our own growth over time through anecdotes. And we already know that nostalgia makes us feel a euphoric feeling. This all sounds good, but while we use information from our past to dictate our future, it's important not to let nostalgia cloud that future. Research shows that people tend to favor positive memories over negative ones. That makes sense. We want to remember fun memories over whack ones. On the NPR podcast Hidden Brain with the main man Shankar Vedantam, he chatted with psychologist Clay Routledge, who discussed the danger of allowing nostalgia to govern future decisions. As negative memories start to fade, positive ones rise and bias us towards ignoring the complexities of different situations and lean away from putting ourselves in other people's shoes to look at an issue, event, or situation. And it might be because we're low-key drunk on nostalgia. Some people want to bring America back to a golden age in their opinion, but it wasn't golden for everyone. For example, the 50s gave us American Bandstand, diners, and Pez, which objectively are cool things. But on the other hand, black teens weren't initially allowed in the audience of American Bandstand, aka hashtag white soul train, and black people couldn't hit up diners because of Jim Crow and hashtag segregation, and well, anyone can have Pez, but they taste like powdered doo-doo, hashtag powdered doo-doo. Here come the Pez heads in the comments. You don't like Pez, you just hate me. Not everyone has the same good old days. If the people in power run the country based on their idea of the good old days, it's very possible that A, they'll omit other people's narratives if it doesn't align with their agenda, B, they're trying to make the present like their past, which is the opposite of how time works, and C, it's nostalgia for them, not for the good of the whole system. So politically, historical nostalgia isn't a platform to rally behind. Listen, I'm trying to drink a Surge or a Crystal Pepsi while watching Moesha on UPN, as Summertime by DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince is on my Sony Walkman. Nostalgia can help bring about positive moods and helps people cope with depression, but our individual or collective nostalgia shouldn't govern everyone else's futures. The past is the past for a reason. When it comes to emotions, nostalgia is pretty one note, and in an ever-changing, multicultural, social landscape, maybe we shouldn't let past passions define the next days of our lives. References. Nostalgia plays such a huge role in how we think about things in the present, but what if the future could influence the past? I'm sitting down. You should sit down. That's a heavy one, but I'm not going to go all John Connor on you. It's called quantum retrocausality. You can find out about it right here. Look at that video right there. Click it. Make sure you subscribe to Seeker, and thank you so much for watching.